In the previous video, we introduced the full scroll dial, a wireless, high-resolution scrolling device specifically designed to meet the demands of serious scrollers like myself. The prototype works extremely well, but there were several things that could be improved, like the minuscule power switch, and more noticeably, the wobble, which I said could be fixed with a larger diameter ball bearing. So we're going to do all that and more in this video. But first, a huge thank you to everybody who expressed interest in this. I've been working out how we can make the dial available to my fellow scrollers, and the gist of it is that there are substantial fixed costs involved, and we can only get this made if there's enough interest. So if you want one, please let me know using the poll over on my Patreon page. It requires an account just so there's less spam, but it's completely free. Now, let's talk about the middle click. You know what? You guys are absolutely right. And it's time I gave poor old middle click scrolling a fair shot at glory. But you know me, a vibes-based assessment isn't going to cut it. So I built an objective tool to evaluate scrolling performance. I call it, So You Think You Can Scroll. The idea is simple. You scroll to hit some targets, and after 10 seconds, you're given a score. It's already gotten 1 star on GitHub, so I think this really has the potential to take off. Here's a demonstration with the full scroll dial. The test only takes 10 seconds. And maybe I'm making it look easy with the dial, but believe me, it's a grueling test that demands speed and accuracy. I seriously doubt my other scrolling devices can do better. The first contender is my scroll wheel, which, scrolling at 8 lines per notch, doesn't have a high enough resolution and needs help from my keyboard's arrow keys. The second contender, which needs no introduction, is the famous middle click scrolling. And finally, we have my space mouse, which I normally use exclusively for CAD. I'm going to have to pass on Vim and Emacs this time. Thank you very much. Now watch closely as I show off my advanced scrolling skills acquired over decades of practice. For the final scores to be comparable, I'm using the same setup for all tests, so same browser, window size, zoom level, you get the idea. None of my other devices even come close to the full scroll dial, so I know which one I'll be keeping. So You Think You Can Scroll is hosted on GitHub Pages, so check out the link in the description if you want to have a go at it yourself. On that bombshell, let's talk compatibility, or the lack thereof. On Ubuntu 24.04 LTS, the dial only works as a normal, low-resolution scrolling device. Admittedly, I haven't spent much time on this, and I wouldn't be surprised if there's some package or driver or some modification to a config file that would make this work. Let me know in the comments if you're a Linux whisperer. On the macOS side of things, the high resolution seems to be working, but scrolling is way too sensitive. And of course, this being Mac, the scrolling direction is reversed. I'm obviously not a Mac user, but if you are one and know what's going on, please let me know. Now let's shift our attention back to the wobbliness of the dial. Imagine we have a shoddily built ball bearing with a ton of play between the balls and the inner and outer rings. The inner and outer rings are then able to rotate relative to each other, and I don't mean just about the desired axis. This is the source of the wobbliness. The standard way to reduce this wobbliness is to simply get rid of the play between the balls and rings. To do that, we stack two ball bearings back to back with some kind of pre-tensioning device in between. Presumably, this is what people are referring to when they recommend I get a pair. The problem is, in the current design of the dial, all these components need to be stacked vertically, and adding an additional ball bearing would mean we need to make the device taller. So instead, we're going to stick to the original plan and find out where bigger ball bearings take us. I 3D printed and assembled a dummy device with the big stuff, and sure enough, the thing feels rock solid. Problem is, it doesn't spin freely at all. Popping off the rubber seals, we can see a bunch of thick grease in there. This isn't a surprise, but it reduces the spinniness of the bearing all the same. The bearing needed to be dropped into a screaming vat of solvent to gain super speed, which improved things just a little. I also tried a little oil, which made no difference. So I moved up to even bigger balls. These glorious steel balls and thick rings give quite a nice heft to the assembly. It spins well and is also quieter. Problem is, these bearings are absolutely huge, and having a low-profile device is pretty important to me. So, small balls aren't smooth, and big balls aren't compact. I thought perhaps there's a happy middle ground. So I made a bunch of test samples with identical exteriors for blind testing. But let's cut to the chase. All of that work went down the drain, because I bought a fully ceramic bearing that blew everything else out of the water. Sure, it's quite a bit more expensive, but it spins super smoothly, and it didn't even require a trip to the solvent pool. In this case, throwing money at the problem worked. I haven't mentioned this, but an added benefit of using a larger diameter ball bearing is all this extra room for activities, which we'll take full advantage of shortly. But enough talk about balls and rings and play. Let's look at some electronics. We're still using the AS5600 position sensor, which unfortunately has a pretty high operating current of 6.4 milliamps. Even in its lowest power mode, it'll still draw 1.5 milliamps, which will completely drain a fully charged battery in under 2 weeks. There wasn't any way around this in the previous design, so I hacked in a MOSFET that allows the AS5600 to be shut off when it's not needed. After implementing this feature in firmware, we can do some power profiling to see what this extra effort buys us. The device starts off in our new powered down mode. Waving a magnet near the sensor kicks the device up into full power mode. And if it doesn't sense any movement for a few seconds, it drops into the low power mode. The sensor is still powered on in this mode, and it can respond to movements in about a tenth of a second. If the device remains stationary for an extended period of time, it goes back into the powered down mode. Taking a closer look at the power profile, the device draws about 6 milliamps in the full power mode and 2 milliamps in the low power mode, pretty close to the datasheet values. In the powered down mode, the current falls to about 0.5 milliamps, which means we have quadrupled our standby battery life. Pretty good. Speaking of firmware, we're using the NRF Connect SDK for this device, and I had the bright idea to migrate to the latest version, which was V2.9.0 at the time. Of course, I started getting these incomprehensible runtime errors, which I spent the whole night failing to debug. Seriously, these things keep me more awake than any amount of caffeine. I was in too deep to pull out, and ended up spending 2 more days re-implementing the entire firmware. Please don't tell me about sunk costs. But at least the code looks better now. With the ball bearing selected, electronics improved, and the firmware rewritten, we can start thinking about the nice-to-haves. Just quickly though, if you're enjoying the video so far, please subscribe. Okay, in the current design, the antenna, which we need for Bluetooth, is buried in here. Now, that's fine, which is another way of saying it really isn't good enough. If we were to make the dial out of metal, having an antenna inside a Faraday cage probably isn't going to go down too well. So I redesigned the PCB with a custom curved antenna sitting right on the edge of the board so it can be positioned as close to the exterior as possible. This is a quarter-wave monopole antenna that's been extended a little so it can be tuned with one shunt component, and it's fed with this coplanar waveguide. So yes, it's black magic. By the way, this is what a new mechanical design looks like. Like we mentioned earlier, we have made use of the extra room the larger diameter bearing has given us. This allows us to lower the height of the device quite a lot, about 28% in fact, compared to the previous design. We also managed to get rid of the small parts in the previous design that needed to be machined out of aluminium for stiffness. The PCB design needed to be radically different though, but we'll talk about that later. PCBWay will be providing our PCBs as usual, and in the meantime, let's do some 3D printing. My filament printer's print quality is still about as bad as before, so it will be way easier to just use the resin printer for this build. The first print already looks pretty decent. Okay, maybe the slicing needs some work. Printing it the other way around, we have to punch a hole through to avoid a massive suction cup. And the other side looks like coral. So I added some super strong custom supports in CAD, which helped quite a lot with the warping. I would have been able to accept this part if not for the time needed to fill the hole and sand the surface. So I tried flipping it back around, but this time printing with custom supports in CAD. The supports were incredibly difficult to remove, but I finally got a pretty usable print. But you know, there's actually a better way. The PCBWay. You probably already know this, but PCBWay has a CNC service, and with a few clicks, I got this perfectly machined part in 6061 aluminum alloy. I selected the anodized finish, which isn't exactly the best looking in hindsight, but it practically repels fingerprints. I also got the same part made in polycarbonate for good measure. Resin printing the base went without a hitch, and a printed model of my PCB fits in nicely. We do have some warping in the walls, but we'll fix that later. In the meantime, our boards have been made, assembled, and transmitted through the ether to my doorstep. It looks nothing like the previous design. Check out the new antenna, the larger power switch, and the detachable daughter board with a proper connector. It even has expansion pads for future upgrades. Squeezing everything onto one board and having all the components on the same side also means it's now easier to build and test. The massive rectangular cutout is so we can use the same thick battery without unnecessarily adding to the height of the device. It only saves us something like a millimeter, which is about 3/64 of an inch, if that's how your boat floats, but going the extra millimeter lets me sleep better at night. PCBWay also sent me a number of unpopulated boards, which will come in handy later. Let's power up the boards, with the usual mix of excitement and apprehension. But there was no need for that. The thing works. We can connect over Bluetooth, and since the sensor's already on board, we can wave a magnet around it to make it scroll all over the place. Sticking the board into the base, the alignment for the USB connector seemed a little off, so we'll fix that in a bit. We'll extremely carefully separate the sensor board from the main board with some cutters. Of course, dropping the thing onto the ground in the process. I bought the shortest pre-crimped cables I could find, which are still far too long. The slide switch has a new and improved hat. And we can close the assembly up without the battery for now. The magnet is stuck onto the dial with some double-sided tape. And we can drop the bearing and dial into position for testing. Now this is legit physical scrolling. The large ceramic bearing and aluminum dial really contribute a huge amount to the premium feel of the device. The aluminum dial weighs about 81.5 grams, or 3/16 of a pound, or one might even say 13 millistone. According to the CAD software, its moment of inertia is over 60,000 grams squared millimeter, which frankly doesn't mean anything to me. But it is about 3.5 times that of the previous 3D printed dial. That means it can stay spinning for a longer time, and is also less sensitive to accidental touches. I had my doubts about having too high a moment of inertia, but it's been working pretty well for me so far. Let's do something about this excessive cable length. My crimp terminals didn't arrive in time, so I shortened the cables the ugly way. Speaking of cables, we talked about using tiny Molex pickle blade connectors in the previous video. For this build, we'll be switching to marginally smaller JST SH connectors instead. And that's a massive JST PH connector which came with my batteries, so I had to swap the wires out. I've checked, and there are off-the-shelf batteries that come with JST SH connectors, which will save us all this hassle in the future. Remember when we talked about warping in the walls of the resin print? I'm guessing it was caused by shrinkage during curing, so I made some measurements and applied the approximate inverse warping in CAD. I also made adjustments to improve the alignment of the USB-C connector and reduce the wiggle room for the PCB and the bearing. The new print is put into service right away, and it's now a slight interference fit for the bearing. The battery is held in place with some double-sided tape and plugged into the weirdly angled connector. Let's speed through this bit, and we can now see that the USB-C connector is much better aligned, and the walls are pretty much perfectly straight. It's traditional to do a few test spins, even though I know it works. But the bottom cover's sliding everywhere. This isn't on ice, so we're gonna fix that by scuffing up the surface and coating it with some rubberized spray. Perfect. Those among you who have been paying close attention might have noticed that the aluminum dowel isn't held in place by anything. The intention was for it to be held in place using screws installed through this hole. But of course, not everything can go according to plan, and I broke not one, but two taps attempting to cut the M2 threads. In hindsight, the anodized finish probably didn't help. And did I mention I only have one of these dials? An EDM machine would be shockingly useful about now. In fact, I seriously contemplated building one.
Don't tempt me, Frodo!
On the barely bright side, it's now pretty easy to swap out dials whenever I feel like it, which is probably never. Anyway, we're not quite done with the build. The custom antenna needs to be tuned before it will perform efficiently. It involves some soldering, measurements, charting, more soldering, and lots of grinding, all so we can get our graphs to look like that. Which, by the way, is an exceptional result, if I say so myself. It's way too tedious of a process to keep in this video, but if for whatever reason you liked watching videos with screwing, grinding, and hot stuff, you can find a separate video of the full tuning process on my Patreon page. Let's now have a look at the old and new devices side by side. The old dial spins completely silently, but stops pretty soon. The new device spins for a much longer time, but is audible at higher speeds. The old device suffers from the wobbliness we talked about, but that's been fixed in the new device. Also, check out that massive height reduction. The bottom of the device has also been upgraded with a non-slip coating, and the power switch has gone from 1.5 mm of travel to 2 mm of travel, which doesn't sound like much, but it's actually a huge improvement in ease of use. Since I've already had it made, I decided to give the polycarbonate dial a go. It's much lighter than the aluminum version, so I'm going to call it the agility build, great for when you need fast maneuvers. But I might still prefer the aluminum dial for its premium feel, and there's something about a cool touch of metal that I enjoy. Now, I hope this build would have been perfect, but there are still a couple of things that need to be fixed. For example, I completely forgot to implement a connection for the battery's thermistor, which will want to stop charging when it's too hot or too cold. Compatibility with Linux and macOS will be really nice, so please do drop me a comment if you have any ideas. Finally, it isn't really an improvement, but I think it could be really nice to have the dial made of some hardwood. PCBWay doesn't include any wood in their list of materials, so I've taken that as the perfect excuse to finally purchase my first CNC router. Wish me luck, and please subscribe.